Like many of you, I'm sure, the Templin Institute has been monitoring the ongoing developments on Arrakis, and as we await to see the political ramifications, I thought it might be interesting if, in the meantime, we took a brief look at some of the starships, vehicles, and other equipment involved. These will not be comprehensive breakdowns, although I'm sure we'll be working on those very soon, but rather, initial thoughts and some speculation. There might be what some would consider spoilers in this discussion, so if you would like to see the events on Arrakis play out for yourself first, then by all means do so. We'll start with the Highliners, operated by the Spacing Guild, and to anyone familiar with the infrastructure of the Imperium, these should be instantly recognizable. Highliners are almost certainly the largest vessels in the known universe, exceeding 20,000 meters in length. They function essentially as colossal transports, taking with them entire fleets of smaller vessels, hundreds of thousands of passengers, and a vast assortment of planetary goods. The Spacing Guild has a monopoly on interstellar travel, so even the Emperor himself must make use of a Highliner if he wants to move from system to system. Now, beyond their tremendous scale, which I don't think I ever fully appreciated until seeing them in action recently, I think their aesthetics raise some interesting ideas. Now, in order to travel faster than light, Highliners fold space through the use of artificially evolved humans known as Navigators. Navigators gain this ability by immersing themselves in spice, or melange, the byproduct of the worms on Arrakis. So what I find very interesting about these Highliners is that in their design they almost resemble the worms of Arrakis, traveling across the universe in the same way the worms would travel across the deserts. It does seem like the Spacing Guild has a special reverence for the worms, and have chosen to replicate their form in the design of these ships. Highliners are much too large to ever land on a planetary surface, so an assortment of smaller vessels are used to transport personnel and material into orbit. The largest ship type, able to operate both within a planet's atmosphere and in orbit, are known as frigates, and you would expect these to be in service with all the great houses. House Atreides operates a large fleet of frigates, and while we currently lack any information on their designation, design, history, or armament, they do seem very angular and utilitarian, and this is something we'll see again and again in the vehicles favored by House Atreides. I think it's interesting that while stationed on the Atreides homeworld of Caladan, these ships were concealed beneath the planet's oceans. That's probably a good way to prevent them from being fired upon from orbit. When they are moved to Arrakis, though, an environment in which Atreides had no experience operating within, they were left out in the open. The Harkonnen frigate, by contrast, is almost organic in appearance, resembling a whale of some kind. Individually, I'd estimate them to be slightly larger than their Atreides counterparts, and they're armed with both a wide assortment of missiles, which seem to be favored by the Harkonnens, and at least one las gun. It's important to note that this las gun was only fired once the target's shields had gone down, as las guns and shields don't mix. Should ever the two meet, they have the tendency to create an unpredictable explosion, sometimes in excess of those produced by atomics. But moving on. We get a brief glimpse of what I believe are Imperial frigates stationed on Seleucia Secundus around the Imperial Sardaukar. Until we get more information, the only thing I can reliably say about these is that they're very angular and militaristic in their design, and waterproof. It's also possible they're not frigates at all, but rather just a dedicated transport. And the same can be said for the next ship on our list, one operated either by the Imperial House or the Spacers Guild. The aesthetics of the ship loosely resemble that of the Highliner, so I'm leaning towards thinking that this is likely a frigate of the Spacers Guild. It seems almost ceremonial in both its design and use, ferrying around nobles and officials from the Emperor. It's also possible this might have been a no-ship. This is a special subclass of vessel that is completely undetectable to those who possess certain powers, notably the Navigators. I personally don't think so, but you never know. Next up, we have the Ornithopter, and it's important to remember that this does not refer to a single design, but rather an entire class of such vessels. The definition of what constitutes an Ornithopter is rather broad, but generally refers to any craft that mimics the movement of animal wings, mostly insects, in order to fly. I have to admit, I thought this whole concept was pretty dumb when I first heard it and doomed to look really stupid, but having seen ornithopters in action now, I've kind of come around. Even if we accept the premise, though, that they're more efficient than traditional jet aircraft, I'm still not sure if this is the type of thing you'd want to be operating on Arrakis. The more moving parts, the more things that can potentially fail, and combined with dust and sand flying everywhere, well, I think you might have a recipe for disaster. Still, I have to admit, I really like the design of the Atreides Ornithopter. It has the same angular aesthetics we saw on the Atreides frigate, and is most easily distinguished by its four wings on either side for a total of eight. Compared to others, though, it seems lightly armed, with only a single hardpoint under the nose. It also has a relatively modest seating capacity, only able to carry around 10 people. In terms of its role, I'd compare it to the UH-1, or the Huey helicopter, maybe combined a bit with the AH-1 Cobra. But if House Atreides is using the Huey, I think House Harkonnen is using the Hind. Footage of the Harkonnen Ornithopter is limited, but it does appear to be a bit bulkier and with a greater armament. In addition to a hard point under the nose, it also might have two on either side of the main fuselage, although it's difficult to determine. At the very least, it's likely not quite as nimble as its Atreides counterpart, featuring only three wings on either side instead of four. It does seem to feature a greater carrying capacity, though. Now, at least one other ornithopter design was present on Arrakis, although not much information is available. All I can say is that it was very old and seated only two people. In contrast to the Atreides and Harkonnen designs, it featured only two wings on either side and was probably a very light utility craft. It did feature a thruster on the back, ostensibly to provide additional lift, and I have to imagine this is a standard feature on all ornithopters for when the wings just aren't enough. Interestingly though, when House Harkonnen, with the support of the Emperor, moved against Atreides on Arrakis, their main landing craft was not an ornithopter, but rather some other design. It's difficult to determine exactly what these are, beyond some kind of transport craft. I have to imagine these are Harkonnen in origin, and likely deployed from their frigates, although given the Sardaukar were also deployed from a ship like this, maybe they're Imperial. I think the most interesting aspect of these is that they appear to have deployed two balloons on either side when making their landing on Arrakis. I don't get why you'd use a balloon when you have so many other alternatives available. Maybe they weren't meant to provide lift, but rather something else, I can't say. It's also possible that balloons are just preferred on Arrakis specifically because of all the dust and sand in the air. It's just a more reliable option. But until we get more information, I can't say with any certainty. Now, it seems to me that if you were forced to go to Arrakis, the absolutely worst place to spend your time would be anywhere on the ground. Of course, the spice must flow, so you don't always have that option. And we get a great look at the spice harvesters used by House Harkonnen and House Atreides. These crawl across the deserts of Arrakis, seeking out pockets of spice so they can be transported back to refineries elsewhere on the planet. They do have the tendency to attract worms, though, so they need the ability to be lifted off the planet's surface in a relatively quick amount of time. The Atreides design of Spice Harvester seems the most straightforward and traditional. It's essentially a giant box transported on four pairs of treads. It doesn't look entirely dissimilar from an offshore oil refinery or large-scale industrial equipment here on our world. The Harkonnen design, however, is entirely different and might be my favorite piece of equipment deployed to Arrakis. These feature the same bulbous curved shapes you see on Harkonnen frigates, almost organic or insectoid in their design. I mean, they almost look like ticks, which is apt considering they're draining the lifeblood out of Arrakis. And contributing to that insectoid appearance is the fact these things walk on legs rather than treads or wheels. At first glance, this doesn't seem like a great idea, when you consider that they're going to be spending most of their time walking across shifting sands. I was trying to think of why House Harkonnen decided to go this way, and I did come up with one probably wrong idea. Given that the Harkonnens have been operating on Arrakis far longer than House Atreides, they probably came up with a few different ways to maximize the efficiency of their operations, and that would include avoiding worms. One of the surest ways to avoid attracting the worm is to use the so-called desert walk, in which you move without rhythm. That's how the Fremen do it. And it's possible that through the use of these mechanical legs, Harkonnen spice walkers can almost emulate the desert walk. There's a few holes in this theory. I really doubt the Harkonnens tried to learn anything from the Fremen. And once spice harvesting is in full swing with all the machinery moving, it probably doesn't matter how this thing is moving across the desert. It's going to attract the worm no matter what. But maybe it buys you an extra couple seconds, and for the Harkonnens, that's enough. When the worms do show up, though, both House Harkonnen and House Atreides make use of carryalls. These are specialized transport craft specifically designed to carry spice harvesters from one part of Arrakis to the other. What's interesting is, again, these designs are using balloons, which seem rather primitive compared to some of the other technology at play here. I think their inclusion comes down to efficiency, cost-effectiveness, and just reliability. If you need to pick up an entire harvester and hold it for a couple hours until the worm goes away, well, balloons would be a pretty cheap way to do that. Why cut into your profits with a more expensive ornithopter or other design? They're probably also less likely to be affected by the elements of the desert. That's just my theory, though. So those are all the major starships and vehicles I saw being operated by the Imperium and the Great Houses in the lead-up to the crisis on Arrakis, but there's a few others that were in the background. The first is what seems to be a House Atreides fighter stationed on Caladan. This is not an ornithopter, but rather a more traditional design, and perhaps one capable of operating both in an atmosphere and in space, but it's hard to say. As far as I can tell, they weren't moved to Arrakis, so maybe they couldn't perform well in the desert. The next is this mysterious vessel used by the Bene Gesserit. It seems to be a smaller version of the Spacer Guild or Imperial Frigate we discussed earlier, and also might be a no-ship, but I couldn't say either way. And the last is what seems to be a kind of spice transport ship, operating above the Atreides refineries in the main city. This vessel pokes a hole in my balloon theory. Because if it can operate without any external lift mechanism, why can't the carryalls? Hopefully we'll get some more information on these designs as the situation on Dune progresses. Now, even though I am well on my way down the Golden Path, I am by no means an expert on the Imperium. So I'm curious to hear your thoughts on my observations. Do you agree with me? Are there things I got wrong? And what did you think of the vehicles and starships present on Arrakis? Let me know in the comments below, and until next time, this has been a Templin Dispatch.